onto my bedroom. That's creepy.
I'm filming in here right now for this little installment of the talky bit, as it were, because my witchy study or studio or lair, whatever you want to call it, my witchy room is an absolute disaster area right now. I took so much stuff off the shelves and so on and so forth, so like there's not even really a proper place to place my camera at the moment. Anyway, so I just wanted to sort of give a little progress update in this whole project. I'm not sure in terms of editing what I'll have said already at this point, but I'll do my best to make this consistent. This is day two of this sort of alter, rearrange, redesign project. There have been various things about my altar that I've wanted to change for quite some time, but you know, you kind of get yourself into a bit of a place where you're like a little bit worried that you'll like miss what you had or that you'll ruin it, especially in my case because it requires kind of thoroughly destroying some of the things that were there before. But I spent yesterday scraping down, repainting the wall to kind of give myself a blank slate. So the sort of burning bramble is no longer there. And I then also did a pencil drawing of the painting that I want on the wall. It still needs some tweaking, but as you'll see, as I go in there in a minute, is based loosely off of, say, 14th and 15th century manuscript illumination, a little bit of early tarot imagery, that kind of thing. Some of the leaves on one of the trees definitely need tweaking in terms of their stylization, so that's what I'll be doing next. Another thing I did yesterday was I sawed into, I think it's called Kallax, the sort of IKEA unit that is my altar. I took a really tiny little saw, sort of hacked away at it, and made the interesting discovery that the inside of those shelves is not even like wood pulp plywood style sawdust filler. It's just cardboard, which was interesting. But of course, I still got really, really tired and sore because I'm a weakling. So, and it took me a while because I also kind of had a sort of shape in mind that did and didn't work in some ways, and lots of sanding and all that kind of thing. And I have yet to do the sort of cosmetic parts of that. So you'll kind of see, I think anyway, depending on what I'm able to show you, that it's been cut away, but it needs, say, sort of a covering put on it that makes it sort of look more uniform instead of just bare inner cardboard. It's a really messy, kind of extremely wonky project. Like, I have an end vision in mind, but obviously I, as with all of my projects, I'm kind of perfectly fine with it needing tweaking as I go along, and that usually ends up meaning that like things like time frame and exact progression of what to do when or what to do next and so on is open to shifting. And usually that also means I make even more mess than I might have done otherwise. So, you know, I won't say no promising because of course I'm gonna try and put together something. I just have no idea what it'll look like in the end in terms of, you know, video making and editing and so on. So anyway, before I ramble on forever, I will show you sort of a little bit of how things stand at the moment, and hopefully the footage will be usable and my focus won't hate me today. So these are the flowers that need to change slightly. I think they're okay the way they are, but I don't know, the overall effect is not quite as historical and also geometric as I would like, because I want to preserve some organic sort of aesthetic here, but I also want it to be that I at least know what I'm referring to. And I've seen a lot of motifs around five pointed flowers, and I also don't think I will have these little curls at the end here, because then they'll just look too much like pinwheels. So I think each one's going to be a five pointed flower, and there'll be sort of maybe a gold thing going on with them, but I'm not sure about that yet, because I'll deal with the coloration when I get there. And then over here, this sort of leaf motif is something that you see in a lot of sort of 14th century and 15th century manuscript illumination. So yeah, so that's the pencil work that I managed to do yesterday, listening to music and podcasts and so on. Thank you.
my door. A black-eyed dog, he called for more. A black-eyed dog, he knew my name. A black-eyed dog, he knew my name. A black-eyed dog. A black-eyed dog.
I seem to be jumping on the seasonal bandwagon and doing an altar makeover and tour kind of video. I had actually been thinking about doing this for a while, knowing, as I've said many times on this channel, that I kind of tend to wake up as summer ends and autumn starts to roll in. I've talked a lot about why that's the case, but for the purposes of this video, I'd been thinking about it for a little bit, and I wanted very much to make a shift in focus. It's not that necessarily my practice is changing in the sense that I'm throwing out old concepts or anything like that, but I wanted very specifically to bring in a much more overt focus on kind of two things that I view as quite related. So the first is an active element of my practice. It's not that it wasn't active before, but a lot of the way I had my altar set up was oriented around things like just sort of mystical thoughts, maybe, for lack of a better term. A sort of very quiet, staid, stationary sort of visual contemplation. But that, like, with that being essentially the limit of it, there was definitely a lot of usability in the altar, but as you will see from whatever before photo or whatever that I end up showing you, a lot of the altar was occupied by, for example, dried flowers that I had actually dried myself and so on, all of which represented the seasons and actually had a function that I used, but took up a lot of space, and as a result, I just found that there wasn't a lot about the altar that was movable, and also with things like the altar cloth, it wasn't, you know, I was a little bit wary about things like ash, and I mean, I burned through the cloth in various at various points and made messes. I certainly used it, but I was starting to feel a bit too precious about it. But additionally, I wanted there to be a lot more sort of tools actively on the altar, and not just the sort of tools that you would have seen at the front of my altar originally, like my bird claw tongs and the little spoon that I use as a candle snuffer and so on. I just wanted more things, more active spells, and more space for them to be on the altar, to be grabbed at a moment's reach, the way I had things set up before,
I have various shelves and things and chairs around me here that kind of create this little cubby, as it were, a little alcove of altar tools. But I would often find, especially because I go to the altar early in the morning, and you know, I have a spinal injury and things like that, that I would sort of end up choosing not to reach for certain things if I really didn't actively feel like it. So again, no problem with all of that, and it was an extraordinary experience, but basically I wanted to start actually making the altar like totally usable, to the point where I would feel almost like making it messy. Also just easier to clean, because part of that is also like, you can make a mess, but if you can't dust it or you can't clean it, then like that's a deterrent about lots of different things. Anyway, the other component of this whole altar makeover is that I wanted there to be more of an element of landscape, which is related to the sort of active practice, in the sense that one of the things I'm trying to achieve, evoke, amplify is increasing things like physical health, but also connection on a mythical level to the landscape here. It's a very complicated thing, because I see the very little difference in many ways between the external landscape out there and the internal landscape that is potentially, you could say, the literal body. There are mythological reasons for that in the framework that I operate within. But loosely speaking, with this element of landscape, I wanted it to be very much rooted in place, which is something that's a long-standing theme in my life anyway, have that sort of roll back around to things like physical health. I have notes here, obviously. And also an aid to things like astral travel, because a lot of my own sort of gnosis-based astral journeys, visions, if you want to call them that, or whatever, imaginings, are rooted in a very distinct outdoor appearance. Sometimes places I've been, or sometimes stylistically the sort of place I've been many times. So I will give a tour of the altar as it is now, and I will also explain a bunch of the items on the altar. But before I do that, I just want to kind of mention a couple of other sort of basic concepts, and hope that they all sort of make sense together. So as you may or may not be able to tell slash know, I live in Ireland, but I am not an Irish person. So I think the thing first and foremost that I want to stress is that I am a solitary practitioner, and that a good amount of what I do within my practice is based on personal gnosis. I do care very deeply about doing my research, my homework, as it were, both from a sociocultural perspective, historically, so things like I have made an effort to go to university classes over time, both as part of a degree and outside any kind of degree program, to like educate myself on things like the medieval literature that contains Irish myths, the ways in which people speak here colloquially about landscape, how that ties into conceptions historically, like when certain ideas came into play throughout the centuries. A very loose example being like, when do you actually see the first mention of the term Tuatha De Danann, and that kind of thing. And so on, like, you know, why is it that we only have Danu's name in the genitive form, that kind of thing. Do I worship Danu, by the way? Like, I also just need to say that Danu is not an element in my practice, so I'll just say that. But like, the idea being that I'm really, really curious about the historical aspect of it, what some of the justifications are for those various things, reading the myths, but then also going into sort of the ways in which that ties into things like medieval hagiography, can't speak. Things like 17th century rise of popularity and emphasis on the Finian cycle and so on, the Finn cycle. All of which, you know, so there's all this stuff that's a very, very much an ongoing sort of study pursuit in study, but then it also ties into things like understanding different time periods and their folkloric practices, and whether or not those can be linked just in terms of my own imagination. And then also, obviously, modern practitioners who are from and of Ireland have a very distinctly different practice than what I have. But I think there's an added element about that that is relevant here, because for me specifically, as an expat, basically I tend to view the whole expat experience as being a sort of permanent, liminal, lived experience. Now you might say a liminal experience can't be permanent, but for me the very act of existing as and who I am is an endeavor, is a liminal endeavor. And part of the reason for that is, I will say that, like, the first time I started effectively doing the work of moving abroad was when I was a teenager, by myself. On my own, I should say. And so, for example, I turned 21 while I was in Ireland. And I had been to Ireland multiple times before that, each time for longer periods of time, trying to be able to, within legal boundaries, lengthen the amount of time I was spending here. In many ways, the vast majority of my legal adult life has not been spent in the United States, which is interesting because a lot of the time people, like friends or family members here will ask me about certain things that Americans do. And I'm like, well, if it involves any of the things, for example, that I was not legally allowed to do prior to the age of 18, I can't tell you a whole lot because I haven't done a lot of that stuff legally. It's interesting. So what ends up happening is that starting from the age around 18, 17, 18, something like that, I was leaving the US and spending more and more and more time abroad. And of course, once I met my future marriage partner, that was of the utmost priority. And it had always been a lifetime goal as well. So even the time prior to that is a bit complex in terms of where my brain was and how I was linking into the environment around me. So, to some degree or other, a huge amount of my persona isn't American, or isn't the most up-to-date American. My slang tends to be a bit out of date, there's all sorts of stuff like that, because I haven't really spent a huge amount of time there, except for, you know, brief stints at school, or to, like, go work a job so that I could leave again, since I was, like, 18, 19 years old, something around there. But coming back to the idea of landscape, as part of all of this, part of what also makes me feel quite liminal is that I will never be fully an Irish person. I'm not from here. I don't exist in this culture in the way that everybody else has existed in this culture. I'm in many ways a bit too reclusive anyway for that. I do love going to the pub. I do love, going into a Cork city centre, but I don't do so in the sort of quintessentially social way. I'm much more of a read by the fireside with candlelight in the pub, like, and fairy lights in the pub, until a friend shows up and we have a chat, and we're nursing some drink slowly that whole time kind of person. It's a very different sort of pace, I suppose. And so what I'm trying to get at with this is that I'm never going to be fully integrated, I suppose, into the culture here. It'll always be like, if one pictures it as the journey over the water, I'm always inching closer and closer to touching foot upon the land of Ireland, metaphorically, but I will never get there. I'm just moving further away from being an American and closer to living out a very distinctly Irish sociocultural experience, but I'll never really get there. So you can imagine that landscape starts to play a really important role in that, and keeping my feet on the ground, giving me a sense of something that is a cultural reference point, a form of anchoring, literally grounding. The added thing is that my experience in the US involved a lot of experiences based in the sort of sensory immersion of landscape. So things like, for many years, in my teen years in the summers, I would end up in the mountains at a particular location, in the Rocky Mountains, learning various forms of mostly American, Irish and Scottish trad music and dance, various instruments, and so on. I've also obviously spent a lot of time learning Appalachian mountain dulcimer and things like that. So there's a very, very, very strong practice-based element in my family, mostly around music and things like that, but also to some degree art and movement and hiking and things like that, but that are very much rooted in things like mountains, but they're the kind of mountains you don't get here. So there's a whole part of me that exists like in the mountains that you can't access here because Ireland doesn't have mountains like that. So this is a very long-winded, extremely boring, probably, way of saying that what I'm trying to achieve with this altar setup is a much more active, participatory, willing to make a mess kind of phase or stage of practice, and that I want it to have direct ramifications for reinforcing that link with landscape. I think in the wake of the pandemic, a lot of us can relate to the notion that it's a little hard to re-anchor ourselves in what our life is, what it looks like, what it was like to socialize to the degree that maybe we used to, what it was like to be able to go to a museum gallery or an event, a gig, a concert, go for a long, long hike once, distance restrictions were lifted and things like that. So one of the things I'm trying to achieve is basically reestablishing that connection. And for me, the last component that I'll mention out of this, that comes along with a very intense devotional aspect around deity work. So my altar has always been very distinctly a shrine to the Morrígan, a working shrine. And without going into too much detail, because again, I think there's potential for people to misunderstand how much I emphasize personal gnosis, and there's also potential for coming across as culturally misappropriative, and I care very strongly about that. But so without getting into too much detail, a lot of my spiritual practice revolves around again, she's not my matron deity. She has not asked me, as it were, to do that. I don't approach deity like they need to know that I exist per se. It's complicated, as deity work always is. But so this is not a dedicant kind of role, but she is the deity with whom I engage. And the most, the aspects of her that are at the forefront that I engage with are obviously the Morrigan or Anand, Maka, Baiv or Baiva, or Baiv Kaka, and to some degree Nevan. But each of those components has a very distinctly different set of associations, even as they shapeshift. So to very, very briefly go back to this idea that I was talking about in the last video around changelingness, shapeshifting, another form of liminality, a difficulty in defining the self, and a desire to kind of treat the self as that's part of your seekership, that you get to craft this and you get to change it as you will. There's an element of that too, like of literally crafting the self and seeing that part of the reason, for example, for me, this is not a dedicant, a role. I am not in the role of a dedicant. I'm just in the role of someone who, as I've often said, exists under the wing, under the auspices of her wing. So for me, it's like there's I find that the Morrigan in sort of these many different aspects and the ways in which you could approach her in the literature is very, very, very hard to pinpoint because she does not wish to be pinpointed if we assign that kind of agency to her and that kind of voice. And part of that is that aspects of her are concepts, some aspects of her are things you could consider practices or sensory experiences like sound, fear, terror, horror, potentially nightmare material or nightmare related material, potentially certain sea analogies, although I think that's on shaky plates, tectonic plates, so like I approach that with caution, although it's also very important to me, ways in which this ties in ecologically, but then on top of that also she has many different names and many different physical forms she takes. So for me, a lot of this needs to be anchored in literal right in front of me practice, and then that needs to be reinforced by going out into the world with a healthier body and an ability to explore, and hopefully from the autistic perspective, with an ability to be a little less overwhelmed than I've been recently, because I am used to being able to go out there and go walking and hiking and so on. And I've been doing a bit of it, but I'm very easily tired, and that just, it won't do. So I think that was incredibly roundabout and kind of weird way to explain what's been going on here. But I will turn the camera around now and give you a kind of a breakdown and a basic tour, and maybe some of that will become more clear as I show you what's on the altar and what I've done to the wall, which you can see a slight sneak peek of here.
Okay, so I'm going to start by sort of quickly panning across the area that you just saw behind me. This sewing machine is Bridget, I will just say real quick. She is an 1888 Singer sewing machine, hand crank and therefore non-electric, fiddle bass model, a member of the, if you know anything about Singers, the 12K New Family model. And I think she comes from Kilbowie because you'll see here this sort of MacGyvered solution I have to the bobbin winder. She's the type that comes with that spoon busk attachment, so I think that means she comes from Kilbowie, but I've managed without it, so there's that. I've named her Bridget, as I've mentioned, I believe in one other video, after Bridget Cleary, who was burned as a changeling in 1895, the last individual that we know in Ireland that was killed in this way. And she owned a Singer sewing machine, and there are various other sort of personal connections to that story that are incorporated into my relationship with this sewing machine. And also, this sewing machine arrived in the post on Imolc the year that she came. So, you know, it just seems with that and the element of craft included, seemed really appropriate. I should note, though, that I do not work with or venerate Bridget as a deity. That's neither here nor there. So here we have medieval ink that I made myself. Skull, I believe he's empty at the moment, but normally this is really weird because I'd open him and you would see my own hair in here, because I use that for stuffing my personal puppets and so on. Here we come past the dulcimers and on to my tarot collection. And this is currently every deck. Do I have any on my desk at the moment? No. These are all my decks. I'm really pleased that I got them all in one place. Now, I have lots of things to say about what I'm aiming to do next with my tarot collection, but that's another subject for another video. So here, quick little pan across the deck collection and my lovely masquerade jester style bookends who keep my tarot cards company. Here we have some of my dolls and puppets. This one is me. So she has, depending on how you look at her, three horns or one beak and kind of two horns. She's very, very uneven in her stitching and in her shape, which was deliberate on my part. And she also has a dark side. So depending on what part of her I wish to work with, what part of me I wish to amplify through her, I choose which side I'm working with. And it also means that her beak slash that longer horn points in different directions accordingly. And there's all sorts of stuff around that that I do. Bookshelf, that flower crown is this past year's Bjaltina crown. I have a waxing moon because it's a moon made of wax. Actually, is it? Yeah. So probably needs a bit of a cleanup. I think I splashed fiber stuck on her and everything. Horns as well for, you know, witchy shenanigan purposes. Okay. Dagger down there, and now we come to the altar setup. So I will back up. I have footage of her with the candles lit as well, and I think you'll notice that these leaves are not yellow, they are gold. So we have, I spent effectively the last 3 days working on this whole setup. Firstly, and like slightly more mundanely, one thing I did was I sawed into the IKEA bookshelves here. And to my surprise, like maybe I shouldn't have been surprised, but there was like actually just cardboard inside, not even sort of plywood pulp or sawdust pulp, which is what I was kind of expecting. So I ended up having to really get weird and so on to get the edges there to be sealed and usable. But I did that basically because it's really hard to get up close to a bookshelf when you're sitting in a chair, and now I have space for my knees. So altar. So here are some of the tools that were definitely within reach on my altar before. Scissors, spoon, which is my candle snuffer, crow claw tongs, for the fire safety purposes and various other things like that, I have hang-dried herbs all about the place, but this is the current bundle in use. I've actually placed the incense holder now on the altar as opposed to further away. My old altar cloth is still here, but it's folded. It's folded in underneath and towards the back so that I have just a plain surface to work on. So here we have a lot of bird symbolism. This is what I call my shadow stone, and it is currently sitting in the Imbolc position on the altar. Because we are currently in the quarter of the year that is diametrically opposed, opposite to Imbolc. I have a little bird here. She has eggs, a clutch of eggs underneath her. I think I can show there. These are gifts from my mother and from my Oma. And seasonally, I have a representation here of late winter, early spring with various plants. And then we have spring into summer. This is Bjeltina here. And the fairy goes along with Bjeltina because if Samhain is the time where the veil is thinning for the entry of the dead, among other entities, then Bjeltina is correspondingly the time for the other crowd to be much more out and about and at play. This is my Macha statuette, who I'm going to make a video at some point, maybe about all my dolls, but part of the reason I wanted to do this altar change is because I like to use this horse as a sort of doll symbolic figure, but with my old altar setup, I couldn't really lift her out and off the altar without making a mess. So now she's much more reachable. These are my prayer beads that I made myself. Of course, we have good old Yorick. This is a Bakelite bracelet that doesn't fit on my hands. It's like the size of a child because my hands are teeny tiny. For such a huge person, I have tiny hands. But this here is kind of to, loosely speaking, symbolize amber and sort of may or may not link into some ancestral work and so on. And I don't necessarily mean genetic ancestors. This bottle here is empty at the moment, but I will be doing a sort of a spiced wine, a variation of a medieval spiced wine in there this evening so that I have that ready for spell work. This is the story stone, which I call that because it has four stories on it. So there's this one where you are looking at the sea with the rising dawn above. And then the mountains with the night sky above. And then again here we have a sort of churning sea with a lightning bolt, or a churning mountains landscape with a lightning bolt coming through, and a sort of a constellation. So the safe sort of mountainous landscape at night, which is a very significant thing for me. And then on this side, we have a figure of some kind, selkie, spirit, ghost, in the sea, also being struck by lightning with the burgeoning dawn above. So I see very sort of almost creation style stories in this. I see myth in this stone, and there's different stories that you can spin depending on the orientation of the stone. Inside this box are some personal items and a sort of a booby trap in there as well if someone were to try to go in, not that they ever would. But there is and I believe the progress footage that I've shown will have shown me putting it in. There's a like a hang-dried style, but it's a bundle of gorse thorns that's in there, and trust me, they are still sharp. So there's stuff in there that's for me and me alone. This is a necklace given to me, or rather a pendant that was given to me on a necklace by my aunt, who has passed from COVID, and I'm very, very honored that she gave it to me when I was a teenager. I have some of her furniture in this room as well. But anyway, I've attached it to rosary beads that I thrifted in an antique store here. Stone from the seaside recently that you will have seen some of that day's footage in the recent Artwitch Chronicles episode on Lud in the Mist. This is a stone taken from an actual cemetery, crow feather. This is a kind of variation on Florida water. except that I didn't want to use vodka because I hate the smell of vodka. So this is also not as much alcohol as you would expect. So this is a brandy essential oil and water mix. And so I'm going to be using it for witchy purposes. And again, I wanted that kind of amber color association. I wouldn't have minded using whiskey because I hate brandy and I hate whiskey. So I don't mind, but I don't have any bottles of whiskey because I don't like it. So I don't buy it. And it seemed really stupid to go buying a whole bottle of whiskey when I knew there was just no fucking way I was going to use it. So that is from a really old bottle of brandy that we never use. This is medieval ink back here that, in this case, my friend made for me. And she gave me that bottle and everything with it, and I'm just really happy that it's there. I do a lot of my sacred journaling with my own medieval ink, and I have plans for that to kind of end up as part of that endeavor. This is the Seeing Eye. It has a secret inside the little stand there that is related to death and grief. And it's interesting because you would be able to see what's in there, but you can't because the Seeing Eye doesn't let you see it due to the sort of shape of the orb and the way light works. But anyway, it is currently in the Lunasa position. Once Samhain arrives, it will move over to the Samhain part of the altar, and the Shadow Stone will move over to the Bealtaina part of the altar. So yeah, it's currently where it is. I use it for scrying. I use it for also sometimes investigating tarot reversals in readings, because you see the world upside down, but not necessarily in reverse order in an orb like that. So that becomes really interesting. So here we go. Lunasa verging into autumn, Samhain and winter kind of part of the altar. We have representations of death here. This is a bundle of dried flowers that I use as kind of like a wand almost at the moment. And we have at the back pagan prayer beads by Black Witch, who also did the Antichrist, or who did the satanic cross that I'm wearing at the moment, seashell from the same day of the sea, an old skull candle that my mother gave to me ages ago, who has faded in the sunlight, but also his wick was too short. I cut it too short, so he stopped burning, and I can't seem to burn him any further. And a crescent moon necklace with any of you who know the Chronicles of Prydain will recognize potentially, and various stones from the seaside at Yawl, including these two, or these three, which are really interesting to me. This one just is really lovely shape with the sort of hole in the center, sort of almost like a hagstone. And then I found these two quite near to each other. This beautiful yellow-orange autumnal-colored one, and then this sort of cubed rhomboid kind of shape that I thought was really interesting. It's very, very distinct edges, and my camera doesn't want to focus on it properly. And then over here you have the candle that represents me because it's wiggly. Those of you who know Tom Waits, a tree born crooked will never grow straight. And that is definitely the me candle. That again also came from my aunt, and that to me is also very symbolic. My mortar and pestle and my cauldron. And now if I pan up over the art, this is a piece by Rima Staines, and this is a little postcard, and this is an original by Rima Staines, which I have mentioned in videos before. Deeply honored to have that there. And this is a print of the Raven card from the Green Wheel Oracle by Danielle Barlow. And to me, this represents not only me and my sister, I am the Raven, she is the set of bees there, but also there's a spell enclosed behind that that is really important to me and still working away. And then to the trees that I painted, you'll notice that the burning bramble is no longer on the altar. And I painted two trees with medieval leaf motifs taken from manuscripts. This leaf motif you will recognize from the Visconti Sforza tarot and various other sources. And you also may recognize the inspiration for this shape also from that, but more distinctly from wall painting that I know of from the Middle Ages. There's also obviously the notion that these look like a little bit like the leaves of Lorien brooches from Lord of the Rings, but that's because those are medieval leaf motifs, which is really kind of interesting to think about. So yeah, we have these sort of manuscript style influenced tree paintings that arch up and over the altar to form a gateway or portal, which is based on an astral journey that I went on one time wherein I did need to pass through two trees, very Two of Wands style. I will link a video on the Mariel Tarot where I talk a little bit about that sort of thing, although not necessarily specifically that vision. And then last but not least, herself. This mask is, I was so lucky to be able to commission it. It's by the, I believe her name on Etsy is The Art of the Mask. And I think this was called Corvus Flight. It's gone up in price since when I purchased it, I will just say that. But this is my representation of herself on the altar in her most sort of cosmic form. Again, all based on personal gnosis. And I actually do scry with this mask because it's very uncanny, especially by candlelight, but all throughout the day, it looks like her face changes and that her mood changes and that she has things to say that are on the verge of being said, and that sometimes almost feel as if that if I were just better at listening, they would in fact be audible. But then again, that's the whole like realm of the imagination and sort of personal association and so on. So there you have it. That is the current altar setup to the degree that I care to explain. Sacred texts, tarot guidebooks, various, sort of next on the list research projects, art and journal entries down below, and some more witchy supplies, some of which are handmade, some of which are not. And there you go. I'll see you next time.